والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. First of all, what I want to start with is remember who you are. What are you? So, in the vision of the Prophet Muhammad, he said in many occasions, Nusirtu bi Shabab, Allah made me victorious through the young mind. Because young mind is very stubborn when they know the truth. I know the truth, I will live up to it. You know, and young mind is very dynamic and powerful and has a willpower. And every nation's prediction of survival, look at the young people. If you want to see a nation have future or not, look at the young people. What is their direction and what is driving their footsteps in life? That's why every organization and every country, every ism, they invest in the youth. And Prophet Muhammad Ali, he knew that. And he always wanted the young people to have the leadership, because the legacy of the parents and the elderly people will be buried in the soil of the young people. And then the revolution of the future will pop up and explode from that soil and promise more fruits and seeds so the nation can survive forever. In another word, you know it or not, your teachers, your parents, they live in you. In another word, you are the extension of your parents' life. You are the extension of your teacher's life. All my teaching and the parents' hard work, if you don't take the baton from us and keep on running and give it to the next generation, it means we did not win the race. And that's why we all want to make sure I am the young man who will take this baton and run very fast and make sure I will not fall down, because if I do, I will not be able to next person in the chain of the race. So Alhamdulillah, this is the beginning of our life. When we are kids, we don't know what to do, which way to go. We have no opinion except what we have been fed through parents and teachers. But when you are young, you are holding the steering wheel of your life by your arm, and then you decide how fast or how slow and what direction you need to go. This is the blessing of being a young person, and all of us will go through that. Once upon a time, your parents used to be in your age. Like 25 years ago, I was 25. And now, it's doubled. And I can look back and see what I was doing throughout all of these years. But as you know, time is working on all of us. In 25 years' time, you will also say, look, you know what? 25 years ago, I was young. But look at me now. So this is how life is working on all of us. And Allah giving all of us the opportunity. You will be a kid, a toddler, a teenager, a youth, you know, and a young adult, and then keep on going. We all go through this gift. Allah is fair and equal in this. Now it is up to us what to do with this youth. So it is a blessing of life when you are holding the steering wheel of your love by yourself. So I will go straight to Surah Al-Fatiha now. Surah Al-Fatiha. First of all, let's talk about the names of the surah. The very famous one, we say Surah Al-Fatiha. Who knows any other name for this surah? First of all, why we call it Al-Fatiha, the opening? Because when you open the Quran, if you get Quran in Australia and open, the first surah will be saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. You go to America, to China, to India, Pakistan, to Palestine, to Africa, anyway, take the same Quran and open it, start with Surah Al-Fatiha. So this name, because it is the opening of the book, it is the opening of the Quran. Do you know any other name to this surah? Any other name? If you just give it right, just give it a name. Surah to what? What does the surah start with? What do we say? Yeah, Surah Al-Hamd. This is another surah for it, Surah Al-Hamd. It's a surah in which we manifest our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Hamd. Any other name?
The mother of the Quran?
Yeah, Umm al-Quran. The mother of the Quran. Just like Mecca, another name for the city of Mecca is Umm al-Qura. The capital city of the towns of the world. So in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah see Mecca, this is the capital city of the whole universe. Because from there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent light to the rest of the world. So Mecca is the capital city of the world. But to human design, different anyway, but this is the reality. So Umm al-Quran, the mother of the book. And also, any other name? Al-Shafiya, the healing. This surah is a healing for our bodies and healing for our soul. Many people do not benefit from the physicality of the Quran, knowing that the surah, it is the surah of Ruqya. For example, if anyone of your family is sick, for example, have headache or something like that, you just do Ruqya to them. Simply, you read to them Surah Al-Fatiha with the name of the Shifa. But someone asked Hassan al-Basri, I think, how come Umar bin Khattab, he used to read Surah Al-Fatiha to the sick among us, and the soon he finished reading the Surah, the person is healed. How come we read it now and the person is still sick? And the Imam said to him, Al-Fatiha didn't change, but you need to be a man like Umar.
Allah.
Because the purity and the decency of your soul plays a role in what you say. As you know, words can build and also can destroy. Somebody, for example, I can say a word, for example, to Muhammad, and after this word, he will just walk out of this place. He will be so angry. Why, brother, I don't talk to me like that? I can also say him a word to make him so happy and satisfied. See what words can do? And that's why Allah spoke to us. And Allah told us in the Quran, be careful when you talk, because your words can be used by people of evil motivation, even by shaitan. The Quran said, وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُوا أَلَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Tell my servants, when they are to talk, choose the best to say, otherwise don't talk. Why? إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Shaitan will use your words to give a wrong interpretation in your brother's mind, and then the enmity starts. So don't let people cut from you a word that will create hate and problems. We say the best for you in silence. So Surah Al-Fatiha, also known as Ash-Shafiya. It can heal our body, it can heal our soul. That is another name for it. Also Al-Waqiya, it can protect you. And so many names anyway. So that is Surah Al-Fatiha. And do you know anything about how great this surah is? What makes this surah stand out when you read the entire Quran? It is unique in what? Yes?
Bismillah has the first ayah.
Yeah. Only Surah Al-Fatiha, Bismillah Rahman Rahim is counted an ayah in the beginning of the surah. And that's why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, with the Surah Al-Fatiha. I mean, the Quran said, revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا. Sab'an is seven. This is 5 and 2, that is seven. مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. I have given you seven repeatedly proofs that you say every day, and it is the noble and the great Quran. That is another name for this surah. Al-Mathani, or Al-Qur'an al-Azim, the great Qur'an. This is this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha. So this one, what did I ask you and you answer?
What stands out, what Surah Al-Fatiha stands out from the rest of it?
Exactly. So it is unique. I will go into that. One day, you know, Jibril alayhi salam is the one who came with the whole Qur'an to the Prophet Muhammad.
Salam.
go to the heaven and come with the ayah or the surah. But Jibril was sitting with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he didn't even go back yet. And then he said to the Prophet, I have some noises in the heaven that I never heard before. And he looked, I have seen an angel who is coming down that never came to earth before. And a door that never been opened from the heaven is open today. And Surah Al-Fatiha came down in the presence of Jibril. It means Jibril did not bring it. Another angel is a special Surah. And we know, and the Prophet alayhi wasallam said, the Injil, the Torah, the Zabur, and the Quran does not have a Surah like Surah Al-Fatiha. It is unique. And then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, as you know, one of the pillars of the Salat is what? Reading. And Surah Al-Fatiha is the Surah that you must recite. If you don't recite Al-Fatiha, your Salat is just like a body with no head on top of it. What do I look like, Muhammad, if there's no head on top of my body? No life, right? Also, when you do your Salat but you didn't read Surah Al-Fatiha, your Salat is headless. This is how important the Surah Al-Fatiha is. It means there is no Muslim on the face of the earth can say, look, I don't know Surah Al-Fatiha. You don't know Surah Al-Fatiha? What do you know then? So you must go home to the recite. From tomorrow, recite Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Day after, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Day after, it takes you 1 week to memorize this Surah. Because I didn't know, it's not accepted excuse when you go back to Allah. We can't say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know. No. Allah will say to us, awalam no amirkum. Ma yatadhakaru fihi man tadhakkar. Didn't I give you enough life for you to do the homework I gave to you? Fadhuku fama lidhalimina min nasir. Suffer the consequences of what you have done. You are a dhalim and you have no support today. Which means not knowing my divine duty is injustice, as opposed to know it. Just like, you know, the daily food we have to eat to live. And if you don't do that, if somebody decides not to eat and not to drink for 1 day, 2 day, 3 days, what do we call them? They're doing wrong, that is haram, because food is a medicine of life. And if we don't live, we cannot achieve our mission in life. Yeah, so Surah Al-Fatiha is must. If you do your Salat Allahu Akbar, what you must read is Surah Al-Fatiha. After that one, whatever you read is a Sunnah. But Al-Fatiha is compulsory. The one of the pillars of the Salat is Surah Al-Fatiha. So Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. When we say this word, now we just try to live up to this word so we can live it when we are praying. And we will become so occupied, and shaitan has no room anymore to play in our mind. As you know, the most dangerous moment in your life is when you have nothing to do. In the Salat, if you notice, when we say Allahu Akbar, there is no time to think, except about what you are saying, because the whole movement is full of words. And if you see how we start our Salat, Muhammad Jibril, how we start our Salat, our facing the Qibla, and what do we say? Allahu Akbar wa Kabir wa Alhamdulillah Kafir. And then we go to the Subhanallah wa Bihamdik, and then Al-Fatiha, and then the next surah, and then Allahu Akbar wa Subhanallah wa Bihamdik, 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 Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah wa Bihamdik. If you notice, there is no room. There are words chosen by Allah to be said in the Salat. And if we are suffering, I cannot concentrate in my Salat, that means we don't know the words to say yet. Because words occupy our mind. And that's why Allah told us to talk, but only with chosen words He prescribed for us. And once we learn the wordings of the Salat, then you will have another meaning to your Salat. You start to love it, because I'm in a very deep conversation. The same thing with Surah Al-Fatiha. When you say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, in here we praise Allah and we admit something very important. Many people don't admit. We say, Alhamdulillah for the gift of life, O Allah. I praise you, you are worthy of praise for the gift of life you gave to me, for the two eyes you gave to me, for the two ears, for the heart that is pumping to supply me with blood and cause oxygen to go to my brain so I can live and think. For the air that you allow me to stay on your earth, under your sky, and you feed me from the food you have created, and the water you have created, and the air I'm breathing. In another word, we cannot thank Allah enough for what He has done for us. وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you try to count the blessings of Allah, you don't have enough accounting knowledge to count them. This is the blessing of Allah. So guessing this word, Alhamdulillah, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. You admit at the same time, many people refuse to say this or recognize Allah as the Lord and the Creator and the Sustainer. But we say this, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. You are the one who created me, the human world, the malaika world, the jinn world, the birds, the ants, the worms, the animals, the fish, and every living thing. You are the one who maintaining and taking the affairs of all of them. So what do we admit here? Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, which means Allah is one and unique in maintaining and taking care of every living thing. He is the only one, no one else. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. At the same time, we admit that I'm not the only one who is here. If I refuse to obey you, Allah, the mountains are obeying you. Everything do. And if I don't worship you, it means I'm one of the rebellious creatures on earth who are benefiting from this universe and using everything, but being ungrateful and not submitting to your will. So, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. You look at these two names, huh? What do you think about somebody trying to introduce Allah to you? Allah introducing Himself to us. I am Allah, Rabbul Alameen. You don't know me yet? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The one who is absolutely merciful to you because you believed, and temporarily merciful to you because you disbelieve. As you know, the mercy of Allah to those people who recognize Him and doing His will is absolute and permanent in this dunya and in the life to come. But some people say, look, I don't know the second part of your mercy, I want it here only. I will enjoy your facilities, I will eat the food you have created, drink everything, but I don't want to submit to you. So I worship my desire. It is all about what I want. Fine. Allah will take care of all of us, provide us, give us the sunlight and everything. And that only wants this dunya, and that is it. But He is the most merciful. This is Allah's attributes. And when you have a Lord and a God like that, there is no fear. Because He is the most merciful, the most kind. You don't know me yet? Okay, take this. Malik Yawmiddin, the master on the day of judgment. Not just the king, because kings will be on their knees on that day. Allah is the master now also. But there are some people who say, I'm the master, I'm the king, I'm the decision maker. Don't do what God say, do what I say, and so on. But on that day, no one will speak. All of them will be on their knees, and that's why Allah said, I am the master on the day of judgment. I will bring the judge into judgment, the lawyers, the emperor, the kings. They all will be under His judgment. When you think of this, you start to say, wow, I have to submit to this one, the master on the day of judgment. On that day, I cannot pay a lawyer to defend me. And I don't have witnesses I can take with me. Allah will be the witness and the malaika. And so when you think of that day, then you start to submit. I will submit to someone like this, Malik Yawmiddin. And when you submit, what happens? You declare again, I submit to you. You are the master. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Now we made a very serious declaration. And we start with, to make sure that no partner with him, we start with the pronoun first. Iyaka, only you, what? We worship. And what is ibadah? ibadah, I mean to adore and to worship, this is a reaction of complete love and complete submission and complete humility. When we fully love someone or something, sometimes we're even ready to die for that. And we submit fully and concentrate to please that one. So after we know he is the master, Iyyaka na'budu, O Allah, in my life I only will bow only to you, no one else. I will not bow to a job, to a wife, to a husband, to a king, to fear, to love, to a position, no, or to my desire. Only to you I will bow. And after doing, this is the first part of this covenant. Then he said, after wa iyyaka nasta'in, after I submit to you and do your will and worship you by all means, then I expect you to help me. That's why I'm asking help from you. Sometimes the first part of the mission we don't do. We don't worship Allah, we don't listen to him, we do nothing. And then when there is trouble, yeah, can I say, oh Allah. But we skipped the cycle of trial and tribulation and test. If you notice, with Bilal, radiallahu anhu, he entered his Islam in a very difficult time to do so. And he knew Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't have physical or army power to defend us. But in order to be a, how do you know a real man? A real man is someone who will be with the truth, even if you are defeated. I'm defeated on my post, on the truth. And who will be against the falsehood, even if the falsehood is the winner. I still believe this is a Bilal was a man. And every son of Makkah witnessed his suffering because of his faith. From the same son, when he used to be at the lowest part of Makkah, saying the same statement, Ahad, Ahad, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. After a few years, he became on the highest part of the universe, I can say, of the earth, of Makkah, the Kaaba, to repeat the same thing to the world. I was telling you, when I was under your torture, I was telling you one reality, La ilaha illallah. Today, I'm announcing it to the rest of the world. And he went on the Kaaba to say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, as a free man. So Allah tests you first. He put you in the circle of test, preparing you for something he prepared for you. And then when we pass that test, he will take us to the circle of rewarding. The same thing he did to Hajar. A lady with her child, no husband, no brother, nobody, no man around. And she was running, looking for water to save the child's life. And Allah let her struggle, running between the two mountains. And the baby is crying, as you know. When the cry of a man mixed with the tears of an infant, heaven moves. But after the struggle, seven times, and then Allah took her from the circle of test to the circle of reward, and what she was looking for came then, Zamzam. So in life, we have to prove that we are candidates to success. And for any success, we have to struggle to get there. Just like to go to Jannah, you have to prove that we deserve Jannah. Even in this dunya, to become great in your education, you have to sleep less and work hard and give the biggest part of your life to your education if you want to be really successful. Otherwise, you take what you are given, and a beggar is not a chooser, as we know. That's why when you say, Iyaka na'abudu wa iyaka nasta'in, this is a very serious statement. And then the only dua in the surah comes now. And we're asking for the best. Ihdina, guide us. What is Hidayah? Hidayah is divine support on truth and righteousness. What is the worst thing is when you are too fast in the wrong direction. Is it very fast? But what is the problem? What is that? You will go in the wrong direction. And what makes it worse? Maybe by the time you realize it's the wrong way, you already went too far and you don't have enough energy to come back here. So Hidayah is a divine support on doing what is right. Or success is when you fail in trying to do something evil. That is success. When I fail, when I'm trying to do something bad and I fail, that is success. And loss is when you succeed in doing something wrong. That will ask Allah, ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. Give us the straight path. What is the straight path? It is the path of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam and the Sahaba. The path of Jesus Christ and his disciples. The path of Musa alayhi salam and his disciples. Every prophet came to tell the people, I am the way. And the words of the prophet always is straight, no confusion in it. But when we follow the other people's path, we become confused there. So Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path. And the straight path is when you think straight. You believe straight, you talk straight, you act straight, and you live straight in order to die straight. That is the Sirat al-Mustaqim. When whatever we do is in accord with the will of Allah, straight path. And the only name for it is Islam. Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim. Sirat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those who you have blessed. And who are those people? The prophets, the shuhada, and the salihun, and all the prophets, of course, yeah, to follow their path. Sirat al-Ladina an'amta. Not the path of those people who know, but they went against them now. Usually many people say, oh, not the path of those people who deserve your wrath and anger. And they say, the Jews, or those who are lost. They don't know the truth and they don't bother to know it. They are happy with ignorance. And there are the Christians. Who said so? Well, Allah didn't mention any. Allah is angry with any so-called Christian, so-called Muslim, so-called Jew, who claim Jesus Christ or Muhammad or Moses or the Gospel or the Torah or the Quran, but didn't live up to his teaching. Allah is angry with anyone who knows the truth and become rebellious against him. We call this a real kafir. I know the truth, but I decided to rebel against it. But the dalil is a state of life, actually. Sometimes we don't know, and then we know. But while we don't know, we can blame somebody because my parents didn't teach me, or my community, or my, and so on. But not today. We are here to learn. Nobody born with knowledge. We're born with nothing for this dunya, nothing for the akhirah, very, very empty. And it is our duty to fill up ourselves now. So Allah is angry not with the Jews, not with the Muslims, not with the Christians. If any Muslim follows the Prophet Muhammad properly, and any Christian really make your love like Jesus Christ, be like him, and any Jew follow Musa alayhi salam, that's all they needed to do. But do we do that? But once we go against what we know, we are rebellious people. And then Allah's anger with those people. Yet, we are not allowed to use ignorance as an excuse. We know so many things in life, even the unnecessary things we know. How come I'm not educated to wait my Lord? How come when I come to philosophy, maybe I have master or PhD or this and that, or when I come to my Islam, I'm still in the primary school level. How come? What's wrong with my education?